Okay, so thank you all very much. It's a pleasure to be here in such an exciting conference. I really have enjoyed it so far. And I'm talking about this idea about against technoscience. So we've been talking about how technoscience has been seen as technology and science as being one phenomena. This also comes out in our understandings of technoscience as being also about society, that we have co-production of knowledge and society simultaneously. So this idea of nuclear physics and the nuclear society or the nuclear subject is produced simultaneously. Also, we might have the work of Sheila Jasanoff, environmental law and science being created simultaneously. We have ideas about reproductive technologies
producing a reproductive subject as well. So we can see that the society, also we were talking about technopolitics, also politics, society, and technology and science are being produced together. And this often comes with a very negative connotation, a critical view. Some people have put together the idea that technoscience is also related to neoliberalism, that Michel Foucault had thought about how neoliberalism was about the fusion of economics with governmentality, that governing the world through market logics and the entrepreneurial individual idea of neoliberal governmentality involved neoclassical economics, and specifically the economics of the University of Chicago. This idea then of both his neoliberal idea, but also Foucault's idea about biopolitics, also brings up this idea of these unification of spheres in a very, as seen as often very negative. We can also identify this idea of technopolitics with ideas about hegemony. These techno-scientific realms make thinking other ways very difficult. So we can also know, though, that these techno-scientific worlds are difficult to establish. Martha Lamplin's work shows this difficulty of establishing these things. And the panel we just had on technology showed that there are difficulties and the necessity of people to intervene at all times in these projects. The more negative perspective also looks at sciences that are particularly elite-driven sciences, and they are top-down, maybe authoritarian, like nuclear physics, often imperialistic, maybe quite conservative in their social views, and they, at the time we're talking about coming maybe after the World War II, supporting a Cold War mentality, and also assuming individualistic subjects. So also they come so with a vision of society, and this will become important in a minute. The less critical, I mean, the less judgmental immediately is also the work of Bruno Latour. Bruno Latour provides a tool for studying technoscience, which can be used to criticize it, but also to think about a lot of other things. And one wee thing we can think about with technosciences is that also that they've been thought about as potentially positive. So feminist technoscience is a way of thinking about science and technology that might be liberatory towards women, or women might drive that science, or women might direct it towards the needs of women and not just towards men. So feminist technoscience is a potentially liberatory form of technoscience. We might then also say that socialism could be a potentially, socialist technoscience could be potentially liberatory. I think this came up in some of the questions that were happening in the last session about that there might be something positive about certain Soviet forms of technoscience. But I think that also what I hear is also people are thinking about in this conference is about how socialist technoscience and capitalist technoscience may share certain negative characteristics. That they both might be elitist, they both might be top down, they both might be actually in the end strangely individualistic, and it may be autonomizing of people. So this idea then is that when I wrote with Gólya about economics in 2002, we had an article in the American Journal of Sociology. In that article, we did talk about this simultaneous development of neoliberalism in Eastern Europe and in the United States and in Western Europe, and we saw them as similar in their oppressive nature. I then came to realize that I didn't actually believe that. So that there was something actually very different going on. So it's good to, you know, find out that you're wrong. So so it's not necessarily it's wrong. It's actually not completely universalized in that way. So the issue then is that I was originally said I was against technoscience because I was thinking about people who actually went, people who, scientists and knowledge creators who are against technoscience and trying to create a different kind of world that was not this elitist, technocratic driven world. So what I'm doing is I'm looking at two particular cases of people who actually tried to be against technoscience. Now the question still remains, maybe this is socialist technoscience of a different sort, maybe a liberatory sort or maybe not. So I'm leaving that open for discussion about whether this is another form of socialist technoscience or something different. Okay, so my two cases are Carl Polanyi talking about a 1922 article he wrote called Socialist Accounting, and I'm talking about the economic ideas of the non-aligned movement. So, and both of these, I would argue, are working, trying to work against technoscience in two very different ways. And in some sense, I think that there is a socialist science of some sort, I think, because I was early on influenced by the ideas of Gibson Graham, who believed that there are multiple systems existing simultaneously within any system. And to declare a system capitalist or declare it socialist is part of a political problem because you've actually just given up the game. So there might be an ideological or political battle you might still want to have. In addition, I also was influenced early on by Hart and Negri, who also talked about how ideas that are, they talked about how capitalists co-op the ideas and the energies of the masses or the multitude. And so I think of some of these ideas actually as a capture of ideas that are much broader than just the individuals that are talking about them, that we can talk about. These ideas that these groups are talking about are in fact widespread notions about what the economy might be like. And the basic, just the basic point of these two and end up sharing quite a lot of in common is that they are not based on an idea about individuals and they're not based on a linear idea of modernization. In fact, they privilege an idea that there is the social, there are social relations, and that this social world of social relations that they posit could, instead of coming into reality over time through like a linear modernization, countries or people can develop along a linear narrative, these people said that maybe we could do this right now. So it's a very interesting alternative temporality. Okay, so we have Carl Polanyi. So first of all, I just have to tell you why I'm talking about Carl Polanyi, because about, I don't even know, like 5 years ago, I got it in my head that I was going to translate Carl Polanyi. I found this article from 1922 called Socialist Accounting, and I thought it was really interesting. But, you know, I actually am not a very good speaker or reader of German. So it was purely will, an act of sheer will. I sat there for days on end. I mean, no, years. Years went by, and I was like, you know, I translated it, and I'm like, oh, wow. You know, like, and so I felt some strange motivation to do this. I'm never going to do this again. But I was like, I am strangely compelled. I have to do this. So what happened at the end of it? I go, wow, I have no idea if this is right. So I asked a person who she grew up in the East Germany. She's a philosopher, a Marxist philosopher. And I said, can you help me with this? We'll do it again. So she retranslated the whole thing. We talked about it the whole time, and we're like, okay, that's better. So then after that, we sent it to a journal, and they're like, eh, can you translate it again? So we sent it, so David Woodruff came on board. David and Ariana, mostly, I was there just like, go! And so David and Ariana translated this absolutely beautiful, I mean, it is a beautiful translation. I mean, it captures this argument, and it's really quite fascinating. So they did a spectacular job. I wrote the preface in the end, so I got to do a little bit of that. But so this is coming out of reading this article and spending all this time translating it. Carl Polanyi, as many of you in this room will know, was born in 1886. He was born in Vienna, but grew up in Budapest. In 1919, he moved to Vienna, and in 1922, he wrote this article called Socialist Accounting. He published Socialist Accounting in the Archive for Sozialwissenschaft and Sozialpolitik. And then in 1933, he immigrated to England and then to the United States. And at that point, he wrote The Great Transformation, which is his most famous book. And most people talk about his work based on this book. His wife, though, Alana Juchinska, one of the main organizers of the armed resistance against the rise of the Nazis. So she was there for 3 more years. He left and went to England and then went to the United States. He then worked at Columbia. His wife and his daughter could not live in the United States because she was a communist, and so she lived out where the border in Canada, and he would travel back and forth. So. Now, okay, whoops, okay. So, let me just, and then he died in 1964. So we have, in 1947, he wrote this in an article. He said, in America there are two tendencies. Some believe in elites and aristocracies, in managerialism and the corporation. They feel that the whole of society should be intimately adjusted to the economic system, which they would wish to maintain unchanged. This is the ideal of the brave new world, where the individual is conditioned to support an order that has been designed for him by such as those people that are wiser than he. Others, on the contrary, believe that in a truly democratic society, the problem of industry would resolve itself through the planned intervention of the producers and consumers themselves. Such conscious and responsible action is indeed one of the embodiments of freedom in a complex society. So Carl Polanyi perceived himself as reacting against this first vision. He did not like managerialism, he didn't like elitism, he didn't like the corporation, all these things. He did not want the brave new world. And so he wanted this other world of this producers and consumers democracy. So this is then the question was, what on earth does he mean? And is this a form of technoscience? So let's see. Okay, so this is the article from 1922. This article then emerges out of several things. Oops. There we go. So in, Otto Neurath had written about the natural economy in Vienna and started a huge discussion. The natural economy to Otto Neurath was that you could have a completely planned economy. It would be completely planned. The planner would be able to calculate what the right prices were. Everything could be calculated and known, and it could be realized. This idea about the natural economy was something that was very popular at the time. A natural economy was different than a commodity economy. Commodities were dealing with markets, and that mixed up value. Value got all messed up. In a natural economy, you could have true natural prices, natural costs could be known. So he had written this in 1919. Ludwig von Mises said, socialism is impossible. And I think the important thing about von Mises is that he said socialism was impossible. It wasn't just impossible because of calculation problems. He said it was impossible because you always have to have private property. And so that was his key element that he was talking about. So this article was in fact a response to Mises saying, from Karl Polanyi saying, yeah, actually socialism is possible. Okay, but it's not this guy's socialism, it's another socialism that Karl Polanyi wanted. So he sets up this idea about, let me just see what I have here. And the important thing about this is that he's in Vienna at a particular time and he's experienced particular things. And I think this is important about the taking in of these ideas that Karl Polanyi was taking mass ideas of, were all over the area at the time. And I want to be, actually I did not say this earlier, is that Karl Polanyi and the Non-Aligned Movement, these ideas are actually, people have been talking about provincializing Europe and looking to the margins to understand indigenous forms of science. And so we can see these two forms as, in fact, we could say indigenous forms of Central and East European knowledge. These are being created at a particular time in the 1920s in this place. And so, and these ideas are then in dialogue with the Third World, and I use those terms, but I hope that it's okay for the moment. So Karl Polanyi is experiencing in Hungary, there is a Soviet, or in Hungary, the Soviet, there's a Soviet, what's it called? There's a Soviet Republic in Hungary, there's a Soviet Republic in Munich, and then there are the, there's the Bolshevik Revolution, and there is also Red Vienna. He arrives in Vienna at this incredible time of municipal socialism. They're building what they perceive as a socialist society based on all kinds of, not like a Soviet model, but a different model. He finds this very, very inspiring, and that, so he creates his ideas based on what he's seeing in these different areas, and people are all talking about these things. His idea about socialism is that there is, first of all, that there are two components. One is that the socialist society that he's imagining is created to maximize productivity. There are maximum number of goods at the minimal labor effort. So to him, labor is a difficult thing that people shouldn't have to do more than, he talks about burdens and efforts and things like that in the article. This is, maximum productivity has natural costs. These are what he labels as natural costs. So he's thinking about Otto Neurath. He then says that there's also a second component that Otto Neurath and other people did not consider, is that there needs to be social justice, and that's his word. He wrote it down specifically that his word was supposed to be translated as social justice. He says that these are the social priorities determined democratically by all members of society, and he thinks of these as social costs. So these are the natural costs and the social costs. And social justice is not, is a distribution of labor and the just distribution of produced goods, but it isn't just distribution, it is also the socially useful direction of production. He wanted to have both these things involved with that. Okay, so he imagines, he imagines that this society has certain components, and I'll come back to this. He calls this functional socialism, and functional socialism would get rid of private property completely. There would be no, I mean, not completely, private ownership of the means of production would end. And you would have instead producer associations who are made up of all people, because all people are mostly working in some way, so that people as workers would become a member of the producer association. They would deal then with decision making about the cost of things and what their prices should be, and they would also represent the interests of producers. Every single person could be part of a producer association. There'd be some in certain industries would have their own, there'd be local ones, there'd be national ones, and so this was an idea that there'd be producer associations, and then there would be the commune. And the commune would deal with us as consumers, and that it would deal with the social costs and decisions about what the social justice should be. So you can see here that this is very much a democratic mode that he's thinking about, and he's trying to get rid of any kinds of elites involved. Also, what's interesting here is that he sees that in every person, every person doesn't have one function. Every person has multiple functions, that we are several different people simultaneously. And this is the problem that someone like von Mises didn't understand. Von Mises saw you are a worker and you're a capitalist, and you know that's a, he just saw people as one thing. So Rosner explains this. According to Polanyi, these organizations do not represent distinct social groups, but the same people in different economic functions. In a socialist economy, the basic principle of economic organization will not be the same interests of different people, the organizing principle of the capitalist system, but different interests of the same people. And you have to remember that he got rid of private ownership of the means of production in order to have, he's thinking of that as this system is necessary. Okay, so in general, let me just go forward a second. Oh yeah, okay. So this idea that he has comes from this guy Friedrich von Wieser, and these are all people that are from the marginalist tradition, the Austrian school of economics. He's very much using Austrian economics. He is very inspired by these ideas, and he's using Wieser to talk about this idea of Zurechnung. And Zurechnung is about how you can do imputation. This is how to figure out prices, and you can figure out prices through a market, Or you can figure, or you could have the social, the planner, the central planner decide on what the value of something will be. But Carl Polanyi said, actually you don't need to have a mathematical planner and you don't need to have a market. You can actually do this through democracy. And his idea about democracy was is that democracy was supposed to be a radical democracy that would extend from the political realm to the economic realm. He, and so it's this strange idea that that socialism creates simultaneously markets and democracy are simultaneously created. This seems a little bit strange because I think that also right-wingers will say the same thing. People from the Austrian school would often say that's the case, but I think that they would not, they want to have private property and they want to have a division between the economy and society. So we can see that in Carl Polanyi's idea is that there's a society in contrast to Foucault's society of being biopolitically managed. In Carl Polanyi, it's an active society. And he even suggests that that the social and society can't even exist under capitalism. There can be nothing like this. He believed that that was an idea at the time that in fact the capitalists wanted to protect the economy from society. They had just begun the franchise, and so people could vote. And there was this idea that you could vote in socialism, or you could have a revolution and bring it in. And there was an idea that, in fact, Carl Polanyi wanted to have these things together. And so so in the 1920s and 1930s in Austria, capitalists sought to stop workers from introducing socialism either through elections, and they also wanted to stop them from having an armed uprising, which his wife was involved with. And they Polanyi was interested in the idea of the social as being socialism itself. And this is unusual to us because we think of social as so boring. It means just social interaction. But at this time in the 1920s, and I think the 1920s is a very generative time, is that the social was seen as radically new. And it meant that everyone had the power to change the system. And so this is, in some sense, it was seen as a new kind of world. Okay, so now I want to then bring another group in, the non-aligned movement. So the non-aligned movement, for some people that are younger don't know about the non-aligned movement, but the non-aligned movement was the third world and parts of the second world, specifically Yugoslavia, as Ivana brought up earlier. Were seeing themselves as not being helped by the Soviet Union or by the United States, and they sought to not align from them and align with each other. This set into motion there was a very big interest in the political aspects of this, that there would be new forms of sovereignty, new forms of participation. What I'm interested in is the economic side, which is not as written about as much. Many parts of the third world and parts of the second world were interested in investing and trading with each other. This would mean creating an economically different world than we have now. And so part of this was the UN Conference on Trade and Development, which is called UNCTAD. It began in 1964 in Geneva, and it was run by a Argentinian economist, Raul Prebisch. He was the Secretary General and at the beginning. And this place was an unusual place of ideas that we don't often put together with the third world. So here's Che Guevara at the 1964 meeting. This conference must also establish in plain terms the rights of all people to unrestricted freedom of trade and the obligation of all state signatories of the agreement emanating from the conference to refrain from restraining trade in any manner, direct or indirect. Okay, now this is, there are many reasons for his call for free trade, and the basic reason is because the US wouldn't let them have free trade. So this is a very intriguing idea. This idea about, and this is my second idea, is that UNCTAD was definitely about planning and about experts and about economists, but it was also about an idea of a different kind of society. We might live in a fundamentally different world, and this fundamentally different world came from neoclassical economics, which seems so strange because people usually don't think of neoclassical economics as very liberatory. So, but it was actually trying to take the ideas of the neoclassical economics and create, to take them seriously. And if you take them seriously, it involves a totally different world than we've ever lived in. So, So in the world of the third world, there was an issue that you had in the colonial world system, or the colonial international system, I like to say, because it was not actually very global at all. In the colonial system, there was a bilateral relationships between the colony and the metropole. Those were bilateral relationships, so everybody had bilateral relationships. They did not have many relationships with each other. The colony specifically had very few relationships, and there was very little infrastructure that would link the colonies to each other that would allow them to have trade or have markets or anything like that. So UNCTAD was very, very interested in trying to create new kinds of relationships between the colonies, the former colonies now. One of the first things that they were interested in, which is very strange, is, oops, I went backwards, here, I'll go there. Okay, so the first one is they were very interested in structural adjustment. Now, this seems strange because structural adjustment is the ideas of the World Bank and the IMF. But at this time, the ideas of structural adjustment were that the whole world should structurally adjust. The whole world should redistribute the means of production, take it out of the core, and distribute it evenly. This would then mean that every single country would have its own competitive advantage and be able to compete on a free market. This was so there was an idea that you'd have redistribution of the means of production and create this new world. The idea was predominantly also that the structural adjustment should happen to the US first and to England first. This was a major importance. But of course we know what happened is structural adjustment happened to the third world, and that was a key problem. So there was pro-structural adjustment. They were also, as we can see from the Che Guevara quote, pro-free trade, pro-competitive markets, pro-export-oriented production. This was in the face of countries in the former colonial powers were trying to maintain their power and refused to do trade with any of the socialist countries, or refused to do trade with any country doing trade with the socialist countries. So this was quite an extreme form of non-free trade that was going on. Another thing about this utopian view was that they were very interested in moving beyond the bilateral relationships. The bilateral relationships meant that the former colonies still had great power over people. They would go into meetings, and no one was allowed to talk about what went in those meetings. So when the former colonies had to do a debt negotiation, they were in the room with the debtors without any other group with them. So they had no leverage, no knowledge about what was going on in the other negotiations. The UNCTAD said, we want to have a multilateral world where there are institutions that allow for rules that are universal. Everyone follows the same rules. There is not some ad hoc rule you made up in some meeting. So this is a call for multilateral universalism. This also is importantly a relational view. It was an idea that the world is related, and that countries are in bad situations because of the whole structure of the global economy. And so they wanted to create a fundamentally different economy that would have relationships, that countries, rather than having a few relationships, would have many, many relationships. And not just relationships with people, with countries nearby, but Yugoslavia and India had huge amounts of trade relationships. Or even today we see the leftovers of this. I think that one of Bulgaria's largest trading partners is Syria. This comes out of the non-aligned movement, period. So we have this relational idea. This goes in complete contrast to the IMF and the World Bank, because the IMF and the World Bank have a very modernization view. They see every country isolated, moving along the modernization tract. So they are to do things on their own. So, and that's very different than UNCTAD. UNCTAD is like, we're all doing this and we've got to figure out how to do this together in some way. Okay, so they were very much into what they called economic cooperation among developing countries. Just a few, I think I have about maybe 8 minutes or something, but so we also have that they were very anti-laissez-faire. I said earlier that they were pro-free market, but they're anti-laissez-faire. Laissez-faire is an idea that you let it be, right? So you let the situation stay as it is. But the UNCTAD people believe that if you let things stay as they are, then you'll continue to have colonialism, just in a new form. So the idea is that you want to get rid of laissez-faire and actually actively create institutions that allow for free trade, that allow for new markets, and to allow for some kind of new economy that would be fundamentally different in the past. If you didn't, if you let things go as they are, or you just don't have anything. And then there was an idea that there would be a variety of ways to implement this. You could implement it, they believed, if they were being really utopian, that there would be a UN vote. And everyone raised their hands because the non-aligned world was over 100 countries, and if they raised their hand, they could change the vote. This, for reasons that aren't clear to me, never occurred, but of course there's also many reasons to understand why that never happened. another form of immediate implementation would also be some kind of planner would take over the world. That was another idea that people thought. And then there was an idea that if Che Guevara have a world revolution, and you could implement this system. The system was this idea of neoclassical economics, and the idea of its socialist utopian origins was from an earlier time as well. There are stories from University of Chicago economists that a very famous economist, which I'm blanking on his name, was at LSE. When he learned about these ideas in the 1920s, he immediately went to go talk to Trotsky in Mexico to go tell him that this is going to be the answer to the whole problem, that neoclassical economics was going to help bring about a new kind of socialism. Okay, so I've just been talking about how these two forms of economic thinking are maybe can be thinking about trying to create an alternative to technoscience in its less liberatory forms. They're two very different examples. Carl Polanyi's example is creating a sort of radical form of democracy that would bring in a socialist world that is less elitist and less driven top down. But we can also see in the case of the non-aligned movement that there is another possible world that is of very top-down, maybe very elitist, but also is based on a sort of a utopian view of egalitarianism that that also is equally against technoscience in other forms. So also on top of that, as I talked about at the beginning, they're both not interested in individuals, and they're not interested in a linear development pathway, but instead they're interested in the social and the possibility of making change immediately. This is these ideas, and I didn't explain this fully with the non-aligned movement. These ideas come out of the Central Europe and Eastern Europe in the 1920s, and then in the developing world later. So, but I want to leave it open to discussion about whether this is this against technoscience, or is this another form of socialist technoscience? Thank you.
Situation in the early Soviet experience where a certain kind of techno-scientific optimism that is shared by a lot of the Soviet actors and yet at the same time cannot be explicitly acknowledged, because the figure we're talking about is Alexander Bogdanov, and of course because of his run-in with Lenin, you know, his particular not-so-realist epistemology has to be downplayed, okay? And of course, after 1918 or so, after 1920, you know, after the whole proletarian culture movement is kind of pushed a little bit to the side, Bogdanov becomes politically marginal, although he remains intellectually active. But the thing about Bogdanov and his whole notion that you can have a technologia, right, a science of organization, is that he truly believes that knowledge is something that's just highly fungible. Okay, whatever it is we need to do, you know, people simply have to math, you know, so a core set of techniques, there's a seamlessness between knowledge and skill that he sees at play here. And that you ought to be able to just master a few. He's already writing this in 1908, 1909, 1910, that all you really need to do is to master a few of these basic skills, and you ought to be able to move from one domain to another and be productive, okay? Wherever we need for our building of the socialist economy. What you find in the 1920s is that, and it's a highly anti-disciplinary vision of things, right? He hates the idea of science as a set of guild interests, right? And he just really loves to, in institutional terms, he'd love to just break that down, okay? The knowledge producers on the ground in the 1920s are not necessarily on board for this. There are certain disciplinary prerogatives that make sense to them and that have a certain epistemological coherence to boot. So I'd be curious to hear, in Polanyi's sort of push back against technoscience as this totalizing exercise, right? Does he have ways of talking about the fungibility of knowledge that say, yeah, here are the points of friction. This is why certain kinds of knowledge can't just be, rendered completely mobile in the way that Bogdanov would like to imagine they can be. And yet, we still have a basis for a collective enterprise and so forth. Could you perhaps reflect a little bit on that?
Okay, well, thank you. The thing about Polanyi is that his idea is not that anyone can do any science, right? That in fact the workers are the ones that know best. And so whatever you're working in, you're going to be making decisions about. So it's not just we can talk about any science, but the people working in the industry who know about it are going to be doing this work. I would like to say as a side point, I think it was in relation to Layla's work, this issue too about workers and their knowledge is, there's an article written by Steve Vallis in the, I think in ASR, the American Sociological Review, where he talks about under capitalism until very, very late, there's also this bodily knowledge that workers have. He talks a lot about workers in paper factories who, I think it's into through the 80s, they are they take their shoes off and walk on the paper to know if it's ready and things like that. So there's a certain power through that. And I think there's an interesting problem of labor, the body, the laboring body, and it could be go with the rise of neoliberalism, I think, is part of that problem. But yeah, Polanyi's part of this idea that people who know what they're talking about are working on it. So,
yes. Okay. Thank you very much. This was very refreshing. I have not just one, but a couple of questions, right? You had actually two questions. Is it technoscience? That was one question. And if so, is it equally repressive, right? That was the two things. Now, the first question is really difficult. To answer whether these ideas are ideas of technoscience or not. In the case of the Prebisch and the UNCTAD ideas, I did not really see, there is planning in this, but I don't see very much playing out science as some kind of, that some actors are going to be able to collect all the relevant information and then they scientifically work on this, and then this is how they do it. They basically ask for global intervention. Right? So that would be my answer to this. In case we can look at the surrounding things with regard to dependency theory, then basically it was yes, the big thing was here, a global intervention as opposed to national intervention, which was the other idea. So that would be my answer to this, that I would not consider this as really technoscience. I think what you are saying is really very important, and then this is what I like very much, that this neoclassical economics was about socialism after all, right? This is so provoking that I love it. Tell it to the University of Economics just over there. Tell them, right? That Varas was actually thinking about this, right? And I would love to see the reactions immediately. But I think it's very important, right? Because I think you are making an extremely relevant point. To read these things from Che Guevara and then Welfare, you see, I mean, the problem I have is that this is so much based on illusions, right? So how is that they could actually think about redistribution of means of production, right? I mean, if somebody has just for one day looked at the political history of capitalism and just think about that you redistribute the means of production, right? So for instance, I go to the parliament today and they say, okay, we just basically, sorry guys, we are just redistributing means of production. I think I'm not going to leave for the next morning. So that's really, I mean, I really would like to know whether you can enlighten us with regard to this, that whether they had an idea of mechanism, how it could be done. So, because that's, I think, for us thinking about these things in the longer run, this is one of the crucial things. We might learn something from them. Also, I liked very much your point which you made with regard to modernization theory. I always teach the critique of modernization theory, but your point is that modernization theory is the colonial exercise of divide and rule. And that's excellent. With a proper reference, I'm going to use this. This also reminds me of that you are absolutely right. The colonial system was based on such a network. This is what Joseph Burrett showed very nicely in his book, that, you know, it's a concentric thing, and then they are just, you know, not communicating at all with each other. That's, I think, once again, very important. Now, Polanyi. And this is really, whether this is technoscience. Well, I could see that Polanyi later developed a lot, right? So, I mean, 1922, he had some naivety in certain things. And I think in the end, Polanyi concluded basically that some kind of symmetry of these integration modes is something which calms down society in this respect. So when we have these various integration forms, and this is something in case we are able to combine them in some ways, and then I think that was the ultimate idea. So in that sense, I see a dramatic difference here. Certainly this is not equally repressive. So I mean, very plainly, I mean, in case you ask me, and then I would immediately reply that, look, repressive means that you basically try to control people in this social production in a way to serve certain systems of power and certain systems of capital accumulation. And in case you do this, then you are doing this. This is what repression is about. In case you are intervening on behalf of that, we should somehow balance the position of people in these things. I mean, this, in my view, by definition, would actually say that it is, if it is at all technoscience, then it's much less repressive, that's for sure. So in that sense, it's very important. And then I think what you are saying with regard to your previous article, that I think is very important, because we can easily drop out the baby with the washing, with the water, right? Otherwise we are just this. Now, okay. The next thing which I found interesting, and I would like to ask, because I haven't read this article, my German is just as bad as yours, could be even worse. After you have read this, so after this, for sure yours is better. but does Polanyi clarify how is that possible that people are having various interests and they just shift positions like this? Because for me as a sociologist, and to teach is economic sociology all the time, this is a question I would definitely ask. This goes very much against any Marxist idea, right? Or even the idea of Mannheim, just exactly the same period, right? I mean, this is that interest is somehow constructed by the position. So how is that on the one hand you have interest, the same people with different interests? That's really something interesting, and then I'm really curious in case you could develop in this. Okay, And then the next thing, which I think should be a discussion here, is that this article is also important because it's related to this idea of civil society, right? Which has been the key thing with regard to Polanyi. So Polanyi has been quoted often and often as somebody who was, you know, this double movement and then, you know, active society. And then it should be done. The question once again I have is whether Polanyi could see any limits to this active society, whether he had the insight that this, within the framework of capitalism, this is something, because that would be, I think, once again something new that we would learn. And then the last question I would have is that what would be the insight of Polanyi with regard to the elite in this? Whether he had any kind of an idea that there is going to be a division between elite and non-elite in this respect, because I think that's also important. Thank you very much.
Thank you for those great questions. The interesting thing is I was invited to give a talk at the University of Chicago Econ Department in their Rational Choice workshop. And not only was I invited to do this, which I thought was absolutely terrifying, but also I was, the week before I went, what's not Posner, but the other one, the economist, the main economist at the Rational Choice workshop, Becker, is it Becker? Yeah, I think it was Becker. He died. So I was the last speaker in the history of the Rational Choice workshop was me. And I'm just like, but I, it was really quite surreal. So I gave this talk, and the reason I was invited was by a right-wing economist, and he was like, you, and he was very young, and he said, and he was a neoclassical economist, he believes in free markets, and he's like, you have to come talk here because you're right. that we talk about socialism and capitalism. Both are totally fine under our system, right? And so he was arguing against Milton Friedman, who had provided incorrect information that neoclassical economics, or economics in general, is a capitalist endeavor. He's like, no, it isn't. Now, this guy was no socialist, but he was, this was very intriguing. So he was very, so I, in the discussion, it's a packed house, and they're like, be ready to talk for 2.5 hours. And I'm like, I'm gonna talk for 2.5 hours. And then I get talking and they start yelling, and there's people, the Becker's widows in the back yelling at me, everybody's yelling at me. And this guy, I'm looking to him and he's like helping me out. He's like, you gotta say this, okay. So it was a really very interesting conversation. So I think that in fact many economists actually do see these things, because I talk about the actual distinction, that the distinction among economists is actually that there are economists practice of all sorts of political bents, practice the same economics, neoclassical economics, but they follow a different policy. Policy advocacy. So some are neoliberals and some are Keynesians and some are, and then some are, you know, want socialism. So there's a variety of politics in neoclassical economics. Okay, so then also about the problem of, well, how would this redistribution of the means of production happen? And this is what I meant to refer to earlier, is that this idea of structural adjustment came out of the Soviet Union in the early, very, very early 1920s. There was an idea that that's the structures in the Soviet economy would shift, and there would be an adjustment to create a more industrialized economy, get rid of the agriculture, and to make a more diverse economy. This was an idea of a national idea. This idea that economists were then either kicked out or left the Soviet Union and hung out in Kiel, Germany, and they developed this idea of
global restructuring of the economy. And so there was an example of the Soviet Union that did do structural adjustment, and that's what they understood it as. But also we see structural adjustment in the developing world, not that it was forced upon them, but that has happened, that there is a restructuring of economies to make them fundamentally different today than they were 30 years ago. So structural adjustment does happen, but under very special conditions. And let's see, so he, I think that he, well, Polanyi a little bit, I guess, about him. I think you're right that it's hard to think that we could move between our interests so easily, but I do think that people are often able to talk about their interests as consumers and then be able to talk about their interests as workers, and they're having other interests as well, like maybe their interests because of their children or their family members that cause them to have conflicting interests. And so having an institutional, for Polanyi it was to have an institutional space where you are representing a particular side of yourself, right? They might be, that this might actually be possible. I think you were right that there were problems that he didn't talk about, which Gólya talked about in Yugoslavia, that there are issues with elites developing out of this, and he didn't talk about that. So, he didn't talk about the issues of the civil society limits, but his ideas, though, did emerge out of Red Vienna, and these idea that these institutions were already being created in Red Vienna. He just thought that these things would develop out of Red Vienna, and then you could just keep developing them, and you would get these institutions that would be quite radical and quite democratic. So but what's interesting is most people don't. They talk about the double movement and the possibilities for a variety of politics, but a lot of people use Karl Polanyi to support a Keynesian state or a Keynesian welfare state, like Fred Bloch and others very interested in that. And it's very clear to me from his article in 1922, but also if you look at the text in The Great Transformation, there is no glorying of the state in there at all. It's always the liberal state is the bad state that always helps the capitalists and da da da. So like it's the state is not a glorified thing. And so I think that it may be true that he was naive in 1922, but I think that these ideas we saw in the quotation from 1947, there is a continuity of these ideas. Whether I don't know what he thought about their implementation or anything, but I think there's some continuity in his socialist ideas.
The first one is a remark, the second one is a question, and I must in advance excuse myself for the remark. But I will use the privilege of this space, which is a wonderful space for some reasons, and it connects very closely to my remark. Actually, it connects more also, this is a remark to the remark of Professor Meleg. In the last years, it is an irritation, I have to admit it, and again, it's the second time, but it's the last time that I'm excusing myself for saying this. Every time I hear this coming, the future of utopia is dead. And especially for my generation, this is something that we really do not want to believe in. This is also like the part of the existence of this place and some others. Related to that, I think it is related, a more specific question. How do in this whole story fit some anarchist thinkers? And there's a whole body of literature there, maybe not so systematic as the Marxist body of literature, but I think they're quite substantial in this whole discussion. And then an even more specific question, what about experiments that actually functioned for a while? Of course with many problems, but let's speak for instance of the self-management movement in Yugoslavia, which like for a while really succeeded to have like really workers' ownership and direct democracy in the factory for a while. Okay, so it's not specifically about what you said right now, it doesn't work, but I hear it so often, and it's like every time that the question comes, okay, what do you expect us to do, I got this answer so much. Oh yes, I get this so often from my undergraduate students. And then I just keep quiet. But I wouldn't want to keep quiet. And this time I didn't keep quiet because this is not an undergraduate question. This is really a decisive political question. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, but yes, the third time. I tend to excuse myself, but yeah, thank you.
Well, I hope I didn't come across saying the utopia is dead, or I didn't intend that. Because I don't actually believe that's true.
The atmosphere was like that. It's always like that at the end. Maybe it's the end of the day.
Because the people I write about can be perceived as anarchists in many sorts. Polanyi is saying he wants to end the state and throw it over to the people, right? Like, and so that they will run the world, that their the society, that's a socialist society. But also, so the Yugoslav model is perfect. I mean, it was arguing against get rid of the state and make it go. The Soviet Union was to them a huge problem because they got stuck at state socialism. They didn't get rid of the state and go fully to non-state communism, and that's really what that's what the Yugoslavs would say. Like, that's what we want. And that's where we're heading to. You could you could say that, you know, I often say that the state was actually destroyed, and then it got replaced by nationalism and stuff like that. So, but they just didn't try hard long enough, maybe. But the Yugoslav model was the largest growing, had the largest growth rates in the world in 1980. So it was quite a successful, according to economists, quite a successful model at that moment. So I think anarchists are quite. There are quite a lot of them in economics. Some of them come out as right wingers, right? But there are left wing anarchists that want to try experimenting with various things. So the Yugoslavs were seen as a model for them. And that this model, though, is even more interesting than this because they were building their model based on an earlier argument for the model. That in the 1920s and 1930s, I did work on Chile and Argentina, they were talking about how to build the system that ended up being Yugoslavia, that this was a global discussion about how to have a kind of socialism that didn't have an authoritarian aspect to it. It was about, and this is what I write about, is that the dichotomy is not state versus market, it is authoritarianism versus workers' power. And authoritarianism can be the state, it can be corporations, right? So in one of the University of Chicago economists said when he was a socialist, he said that the corporations are little teeny Soviet unions, right? And that he understood the Soviet Union and corporations as similar. So I think we can have a discussion about I present these ideas. I don't think necessarily that any of them are necessarily workable. That's not my task in life. My task in life is to hear these things and write about them. So, yeah.
Also, the anarchist question was rather in the direction of intellectual history. It was not like,
okay.
If there's an influence. And yeah, okay, but it was, thank you.
Yeah, sure. Thank you for the question.
I can't without the microphone.
Yeah, but I should. Okay. There is more comment on the comment, sorry. But speaking about the utopia, yes, I just would like to talk like there's a book of Sasha Lilly, Catastrophism, the Apocalyptic Politics of Collapse and Rebirth, and this book starts from the sentence, dystopia is for losers. And she's trying with other guys. They show that this dystopian thinking and rejecting the utopia is really right-wing thing of this kind of fear-mongering and this kind of policies. And this is, you know, like I would like to support this utopian side. And this is somehow connected with something which bothered me from the beginning. Mm-hmm. Why technoscience is a negative term? Because, you know, now I'm finishing research grant about anti-vaccination movement. Mm-hmm. And what is my, you know, like a result is, you know, I am thinking about the positive biopolicy, positive technoscience, biopolitical state. Mm-hmm. Because without this, you have a polio in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. And, you know, how the technoscience is a negative term. Why we are so neo-luddite or something like this? You know, without technoscience, we don't have laptops or, you know, where is this optimism with the machines, powers, electricity, and this kind of things? And where is this, you know, what is this optimism with Soviets and the optimism with electricity? Okay.
I think that part of the issue with the critique of technoscience, I mean, my understanding of it, and I think you were saying a little bit later than I was thinking of it. I mean, a lot of it comes out of the feeling, the experience of the atomic bomb dropping in World War II, and that drives a feeling of critique about a world, a science in which it can destroy, and that destruction, and then to expand that idea that that there also might be embedded in certain ideas about technology, that those might also have ideas about the society in which we live. And so if we accept technology without critique, then we could have an authoritarian world. We wouldn't have no polio, and we would also have a lot of other things. And we would have laptops, but what's that? Yeah, and so this was the critique is to you can't. It's not an either or. That's the thing. It's not like technology or this. This is an idea that you might have other kinds of technosciences that might be more productive.
Yes, but whatever. There is not like there is a simple issue that you have like a world which is like a something without a shape, and then you have a technoscientific action which can somehow reshape the world and. They are dangerous, but you have like a lot. We have this kind of slide here. A lot of self-organization of different systems, self-organization of nature. Mm-hmm. If we done nothing, the things will develop in some strange ways. Mm-hmm. And you know, there is no like we can avoid of actions. We have to. There is no like you can be, you know, okay, don't do the atomic bombs. No.
Yes, but there is, the point is, I think, okay. Different meanings of this we.
Yes.
So, we take action, but what is we?
Okay.
And Martha? Martha, you want to come?
Yeah, I don't know if how this stands in vis-a-vis this debate. I was fascinated by this discussion because I've been thinking a lot about accounting, but accounting in relationship to the determination of labor value, right? Mm-hmm. So for me, I mean, this, you know, that German Betriebswirtschaft, that whole tradition already starts in the late 19th century, right, in the 1880s, and you have these people who look specifically at forms of accounting, that it becomes a field unto itself, explicitly to develop a certain kind of efficient form of a corporation, right? A certain kind of business model, mm-hmm. right? My comments are going to be all over the place, but what's interesting for me, I mean, this is a little bit what I argued in the first book of mine about the object of labor, but also what Rick Bernanke talked about, which is you have these very explicitly Central European understandings of what labor is, right, what objects are, and that has to be much more incorporated into people's understandings of the way in which these things become analytic categories. So you have cultural categories that become analytic categories, right? Mm-hmm. So one of the things that fascinates me is that the ways in which these people talking about accounting and talking about socialism were talking about explicitly pragmatic issues. These were not necessarily utopian issues. These were issues about how do we solve certain forms of organization? How do we, in fact, reward labor according to the quality or the value of its labor? These are very explicitly, they were not seen as utopian at all necessarily, and particularly by these guys who were involved in work science and socialist engineering. But the other point I want to make, which I'm trying to write about now in this new project on inflation, is that, well, and I talked about in the second book, is that in fact the problem with a lot of the discussions, I mean, I'm not very knowledgeable about the calculation debate, but a lot of the problems of the assumptions about markets is they thought that money worked mm-hmm. already. Both Zimmel and Marx assumed that money was a means, and money is not a means in actually until like after World War II, for most places, right? You don't have money that, you know, makes it make you move around things, right? You don't have markets in that sense at all. So for me, it's a fascinating notion that there's this fetishization, classically, of a market when it doesn't actually exist. I mean, in some respects, that's what Paul Agnew says. Mm-hmm. So when I think about this, a lot of what I've been talking about in terms of the relationship of people trying to figure out the value of science, the value of labor, right, is this elaborate economic exercise that they need to do because there is no fucking market, mm-hmm. right? So between 1919 and 1946 in Hungary, you know, they're constantly talking about making labor They want to commodify it in the sense that they want to make it a monetary thing. There is no money that is relevant that allows you to be able to pay labor. Mm-hmm. And none of these groups are, you know, kind of, right? So, mm-hmm. So these are pragmatic questions about how do you actually solve these kinds of things. But there's this other conceptual issue that I think is so fascinating. So anyway, so I've been working on this. I'm interested in how money is actually used or why it's thought about as certain kinds of forms. So I've been, in addition to the book that I've been doing on work science, I'm now starting a new project on the inflations of 1919 and 1945-46 in Hungary, right? And I didn't know much about the 1919, which was really cool. But what really struck me is when I was in the archives, at the Social Democratic Party archives, I ran across these documents that just blew my mind about, from, but you know, one set of workers from Mezőkövesd, I think, and another from a guy who lived here in Budapest. And they both had theories about money that they wanted to suggest. And they both had theories of money that has money for objects and money for people, right? So in fact, this whole debate about natural goods is precisely a local cultural understanding about how, in fact, you define labor. Because the elaborate calculations that I write about in my book, that they're trying to figure out the value of labor, they have to do precisely because they can't rely on price. They can't rely on markets, right? Mm-hmm. So that's all, and so they talk about aru pains and munka pains. Mm-hmm. So then I start this whole inflation project, mm-hmm. and then I'm looking at the materials from the Supreme Economic Council, right? Mm-hmm. And you see 50 proposals about how money should be designed from Hungarians, right? And they're all about munka pains and aru pains. They're all about these forms of, so there's this very intense intellectual debate going on, sometimes among people who live in Budapest and sometimes among workers who just are pissed about the fact that they can't get any food in 1946, right? And they're all essentially pragmatic questions about how, in fact, do we make a better system, right? Mm-hmm. So it may very well be that there are utopian visions in this, but for a lot of people, it's just like, I can't get any food, right? Mm-hmm. Because there was this great thing called calorie money in 1946, and people were supposed to be paid in the amount of calories that they got, right? So, but it didn't work because they couldn't get the food because the, anyway, whatever. So this is a completely confused comment, but what I want to say is that I think that a lot of what we want to, I haven't thought about this in terms of the calculation debate, but that what we want to situate more historically and culturally, what it means to ask those questions about what is the value of labor. Why is it relevant to ask about what is money doing and how does money work or not work? And so that if you make a much more culturally historical specific analysis of even the, you know, I'm not going to do the Viennese school, but you know what I mean? That in fact these were very, very relevant issues mm-hmm. for people in everyday life, right?
Yes.
And you see that, and what's really cool, which is, is that the people who were sitting out, you know, working in the fields had the same categories as the munkatanosok, as these guys who are doing betriebswirtschaft. So anyway, that just blows my mind. I think it's fascinating.
Yeah, I just a quick thing, I totally agree that these cultural categories, or these, you call them, cultural categories become analytic categories. I think that's that a lot of economics comes out of these environments, and very different environments. But I want to say also that even pragmatic things have interesting histories. So the idea I talked about, Zurechnung, and that was a way to figure out price when you didn't have a market. The Munich Soviet wrote to Otto Neurath and said, can you come here and teach us how to do imputation in Zurechnung, because we want to figure out exactly how much money we deserve. Because they could separate out through this and figure out exactly how much labor should get and how much labor contributes to the product and the price. Yeah.
I've been trying to figure out the history of the Munka Edsheg, which is this work unit, right? Mm-hmm. And it's always been assumed, partly based on assumptions about Russia, that in fact the reason that you made these categories of a unit of value that's abstract and is not related to money is because they're trying to get rid of money. And my argument is precisely the opposite. These were plans to commodify labor, mm-hmm. right? So you develop up into little bits and pieces of activity. You have this elaborate scale, right? Mm-hmm. So you can commodify labor. Whether it's in socialism or capitalism is a whole different thing. So the thing is, what are the techniques that you're deploying mm-hmm. in technopolitics or something to actually create certain kinds of subjects, the intensely individuated subject in socialism, which is the case,